Okay, so today it is the birthday of Michel de Klerk, perhaps the most important architect of the School of Amsterdam. And by the way of his birthday, I will begin by saying a few words about this architectural movement in the Netherlands at the beginning of the 20th century, the School of Amsterdam. So the Amsterdam School is a style of architecture that arose from the 1910s through about 1930s in the Netherlands. The Amsterdam School movement is part of international expressionist architecture, sometimes linked to German brick expressionism. Well, here the, you know, it's used the present tense, but it should be the past tense. Anyway, buildings of the Amsterdam School were characterized by brick construction with complicated masonry with a rounded or organic appearance, relatively traditional massings, and the integration of an elaborate scheme of building elements inside and out. Decorative masonry, art glass, wrought ironwork, spires or ladder windows with horizontal bars, an integrated architectural sculpture. The aim was to create a total architectural experience, interior and exterior. Imbued with socialist ideals, the Amsterdam School style was often applied to working class housing estates, local institutions and schools. For many Dutch towns, Hendrik Verlage designed the new urban schemes, while the architects of the Amsterdam School were responsible for the buildings. With regard to the architectural style, Michel de Klerk, whose birthday is today, had a different vision than Verlage. In the magazine of Quincundig Wick Blood, sorry for the pronunciation, from 1916, Michel de Klerk criticized Verlage's recent buildings in the style of Dutch traditionalism. In this context, the stock exchange by Verlage of 1905 can be seen as the starting point of traditionalist architecture. Well, I don't know. I mean, there was a modernism in Verlage as well. It's a little simplistic to say that with that building, the traditionalist architecture started. Anyway, from 1920s to 1930s, different parallel movements developed in the Netherlands. And here they are, traditionalism, Kropholer, and partly Verlage. Expressionism, de Klerk and Piet Kramer. De Stijl, Rietveld, van Doesburg with Manifesto de Stijl, against the modern Baroque of the Amsterdam School. Rationalism, with the people whose names you see here, again, against the Amsterdam School. Constructivism, Duyker, van der Vloek, the specific brick cubism of Dudok and Verlage. So here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 major forms of or styles, if you want to use this word, which is not, in my opinion, a very good choice, but some people use it, including Patrick Schumacher. Anyway, almost simultaneously, there were these 6 forms of doing architecture in the Netherlands: traditionalism, expressionism, the Stijl, rationalism, constructivism, and the specific brick cubism or brick cubism. And now I will say a few words about the major architects within this movement. Michel de Klerk, whose birthday is today, and well, I will talk about him specifically a little bit later. This was the man, unfortunately, he died at 39. And yet he is considered, and he probably was, the most interesting and talented member of the Amsterdam School. It's very sad that he died so young. Here are some buildings by him. Indeed, it is a brick architecture in good part. And I thought of actually maybe to change something to call the presentation today, bricks and incinerators. Why incinerators? Because Walter Burley Griffin built some remarkable incinerators in Australia. And somehow, you know, of course, bricks and the incinerators connect through the fact, through fire. Okay, so Michel de Klerk. And this is not a traditionalist architecture. This is an expressionist architecture, which has elements which, yes, could be, you know, somehow connected to a certain past. But I think there is a lot of creativity here. And it's interesting that the Expressionist school, the School of Amsterdam, had opponents, strong opponents, De Stijl and the rationalism. Anyway, again, Michel de Klerk, it was also what is interesting that if indeed the Amsterdam school is considered some kind or was considered some kind of, you know, new Baroque architecture, it was also imbued, as I read, with socialist ideas. All these buildings were built for the working class, for the underprivileged. But isn't it kind of strange that you know, the working class had a chance to live in buildings which had a so-called Baroque or a more complex or complicated even architecture. Look, like this corner of the building, or this curved part here at the top. You know, this in my opinion, this architecture was very interesting. And, I'm surprised that after, you know, Michel de Klerk died and Pete Kramer, they began to build bridges. Many bridges in Amsterdam were built by him. The movement disappeared. But I think expressionist architecture has qualities which shouldn't be ignored, because it's not an architecture that, but you could also connect it to an extent with the arts and crafts movement. It relied on a qualified, work which not everybody was able to do. Just to work with the bricks in this way, this couldn't be done without some skills. And in a way, I think depending on such skills was not a bad thing at all. Anyway, we only know, or most of us know, of the steel movement, which was abstract, objectivist, and so on. But the School of Amsterdam was a significant architectural movement and shouldn't be ignored. This is a rendering by Michel de Klerk, and the building you saw before it was built. I think he was very talented, and if he lived longer, he would have perhaps contributed to the history of architecture in even more significant ways than he already did. I mean, it's enough to contemplate this rendering, you know, done for a competition, to realize his very serious gift that he had for architecture. Now, who would build buildings like this today? Not many. And even then, it was the School of Amsterdam. Look at the beauty of the brickwork here. It's really an embroidered architecture here and there. And, some delicious little details. And look at this, these two strange, perhaps, little windows and the mask-like configuration of this part of the facade. This is not an architecture to ignore. Why it is now unknown by many of us is because, there was no Well, it was a very publicized architectural movement at that time. But another kind of modernity won the battle, so to speak, and this, you know, receded to an extent. But it's an architecture that cannot leave you indifferent. It's more picturesque, it's more romantic, and it has the earthiness that the brick, you know, brings with it that we cannot ignore. Even Zaha Hadid, she wanted to create an architecture. Well, forget about the fact that she didn't quite succeed, but she declared, I want to make an architecture that is raw, earthy, and vital. Well, vital maybe it was, if it wasn't so white, but earthy it was not, nor raw. Anyway, these are interesting buildings by Michel de Klerk. I mean, look at this apartment building. Are the, you know, the blocks of flats of today or the Orthodox modernity better? I'm not sure, so sure. This is also Michel de Klerk. We are going to see them again in the next presentation, which is again, still a short presentation. It should have been longer, but look at this detail in brick, you know, which is sculptural, is sculpting in brick. Now, Pete Kramer and Michel de Klerk, Michel de Klerk and Pete Kramer were the most important architects of the School of Amsterdam. I have another presentation just on Pete Kramer. In fact, a little bit longer than the one on Michel de Klerk. But this is a building which I like very much, built by Michel de Klerk and Pete Kramer. I don't know exactly in what way each of them contributed. They work together, but I think it's an interesting building. And you know, the fact that it was built for the working class, that it was animated by socialist ideals, makes me appreciate it even more. Because why should, you know, the working class or those underprivileged have banal buildings? Well, it seems Michel de Klerk and Pete Kramer wouldn't have that idea. Why shouldn't the working class and also the underprivileged enjoy also, you know, sculptures and, you know, a certain complexity in the buildings that they lived in? This is an interesting park. I think Pete Kramer was responsible for the general layout. He also built one or two buildings in this park. Not all the buildings are still alive, so to speak. This was commissioned by a private investor and some expressionist architects associated with the Amsterdam School contributed with interesting buildings here. Look at them, you know, these are, you know, these are buildings which look both ways, towards the past and towards what we might call the future. They have traditional elements, you know, like the roof in a certain way. But even the more cubistic buildings, you see, because of the organic materials, the natural materials, have this earthiness which softens the abstractness of the, you know, rigid geometries. And the brick helps. They were also not afraid of certain fluidities. Maybe that's why it was this movement, you know, described as being somehow Baroque. This, the building, the structure, this is very a small structure, but it's very, very exquisite. I hope I have other pictures with it. Yes, here it is. You know, it's, it's truly a very interesting little building, you know, which has exquisite brickwork and even sculptural element, and then this eco roofing, you know, is sustainable, is capricious, is whimsical. It's interesting, I would say. Now, the Olympic Stadium in Amsterdam, which was built in 1928 by this architect, Jan Wils, again, a brick architecture. But about the School of Amsterdam, we can say more things. I will stop here by now, and we'll look again at the works of Michel de Klerk, whose birthday is today. Let's look at Michel de Klerk, just a second. Okay, he was born in 1884 and died in 1923. So he died at 39. This was the man. If we can't call him so, but as a young man, he almost looks boyish. So Michel de Klerk, born the 24th of November, 1884, and died on the same day when he was born, the 24th of November, but in 1923. So when he became 39, on that very day, he died. What a sad thing. Born to a Jewish family, he was one of the founding architects of the movement Amsterdam School, Expressionist Architecture. Early in his career, he worked for other architects, including Edward Kuipers. For a while, he also employed the Indonesian-born Lim Wien Chie, who would later become his country's pioneering proponent of the Amsterdam School and modern architecture. Of his many outstanding designs, very few have actually been built. One of his finest completed buildings is the ship, Het Schip, in the Amsterdam district of Spaardammerboort. I have seen them. I was there. There was this magazine, I don't know if I pronounce well, Wendingen, from 1918 to 1932, which published buildings, projects, and drawings by Michel de Klerk. And three of the covers of this magazine were designed by him, and I will show them now. This is a different kind of aesthetics altogether, you know, references to, archaic, art, and, I guess even architecture. We see the Sphinx there. It's an architecture of memory. And, and yet it was not traditionalist. So this is kind of interesting. The School of Amsterdam did look back, but didn't fall in the trappings of what traditionalism would stand for. Look even at the writing, it's an expressionist form of graphics that relates to the architecture that he himself was advocating. Or look at this drawing. I would say that, this cover for this magazine, which was done by Michel de Klerk, I find it engaging and mysterious and with a psychic content. It's not that clean, chromatically engaging abstract modernity that De Stiel advocated. Here is something else. I would almost say that this is an architecture under the sign of the moon. Yes, it's a moon architecture. And look here, what kind of architect would have drawn something like this with this dragon? But I think there is a lot of potential deriving from, contemplating the works of the School of Amsterdam. And for our time, I think its suggestions could be taken seriously if we are to talk about sustainability, even about democracy, since socialist ideals animated these architects. You know, and at the same time, paradoxically, an architecture that was very, you know, interesting and engaging because of its, you know, intricacies and Baroque elements and so on. Again, the dragon. Well, Daniel Lipskin built a dragon for China in Milan a few years ago. You know, in a way, the fluidities permitted by the new technologies of today could make us assume, you know, the sinuousness of such a mythical creature as the dragon. Now, from 1924 to 1930, here are some buildings by Michel de Klerk. We wouldn't say that this is not modern. It is modern, but it's a different kind of modernity. And I actually admire the Dutch for allowing for such a variety of expressions, and also, of course, Michel de Klerk for you know, building something like this. Now this is more passéist in a way, but these are pages from the magazine that I mentioned before. Drawings by Michel de Klerk. The continuously restless Dutchmen, you know, they continuously reinvent themselves and question themselves and move forward. I admire them a lot. Amsterdam West, working class socialist housing consisting of three groups of buildings on the north side, on the south side, and on the third, you see the ship, and we are going to look at it. So they were all built between 1910 approximately and 1920. You know, they began to build at the end of the First World War and then continued after the end of the of that war. So these are done by Michel de Klerk here. It's strange, I had been there, but I never saw until now. I mean, I made this presentation, but I didn't contemplate carefully enough this view from the air. And I forgot exactly how, but yeah, a remarkable architecture, which is present often in the histories of architecture, you know, was built here. Essentially blocks of flats for the underprivileged, for the working class. We saw already this rendering, and I think his manner of expressing his ideas was excellent, you know, and this was not done with software, it was done through manual drawings. And look at this building, you know, I mean, the presence of the mask, as I call it, and you saw on the cover of that magazine that, you know, he had an interest in, you know, a certain art from exotic places, if we are to call them so. This exoticism, because architects actually didn't find inspiration in, you know, art from Africa or from I don't know what islands and so on. Let's not forget Paul Gauguin left France and went, you know, to the islands to live and die there and inspire himself from. But architects never, or very, very rarely, and this is one of the rarest examples where architects welcomed suggestions and inspiration from, you know, forms of art and perhaps architecture as well, from different continents and you know, from different times in this way, as we see in this building. I find this building very interesting, and it's not an expensive building. It's not an, you know, it's, this is not a building with expensive penthouses and built for the rich. It was built for the working class people. And it is even more remarkable that, that this architect and his associates, you know, like Pete Kramer, worked for the humble citizens, so to speak, with a devotion that in the past or in the present, for that matter, only the rich can afford. This is truly because the conception is that inexpensive blocks of flats should be unavoidably, you know, rationalistic and banal. Well, here we have an example of something else. It is art. It is art that they brought into the making of the building. And, I don't know exactly how they were able to do it. I mean, look at these sophistications in the corner with this, embroidered brickwork. Bravo to them. Also, they didn't say no to ornament. You know, discreetly as it is present, it is present. It is not rejected. Michel de Klerk. We had a chance last year to have with us here on Zoom the vice mayor of Hague, the capital of the Netherlands. He spent some time with us here, and then he even sent me some emails with some interesting materials about the Dutch artist Constant, a very interesting man. And he said that this is now a museum. I don't know if it is not actually a museum of architecture. Anyway, it is a very interesting building, and so are these, also built by Michel de Klerk. And also, it has to be said, you know, this is an architecture born in Amsterdam and built in Amsterdam. And Amsterdam is a, you know, kind of a brick city. So it's, you know, the genus loci is respected in Amsterdam through these buildings. Although there are so-called betrayals because of the creativity and the exuberance of the architects. So this architect built these buildings until he was 39. He died on the very day when he became 39. Imagine he lived 30 years more. We would have had many other buildings by him, but it's a romantic architecture, and romanticism and expressionism make us feel uncomfortable because we are more or less against romanticism and against, expressionism. Michel de Klerk, we have seen this building in the previous presentation. Now, Amsterdam South, the Down, working class socialist housing by Michel de Klerk and Piet Kramer, 1920-1923. Lots of buildings, as you can see. The most unusual blocks of flats now. And here you have it, with the imagination, you can break the, the rationalist paradigm. Okay, it deserves a better, a longer and more richer presentation. I have another one on Piet Kramer. Maybe should I talk about Piet Kramer now? Okay, I can say a few words about Piet Kramer as well, since he was, he collaborated with Michel de Klerk. And let's see what Piet Kramer, the other important, presence in the field of expressionist architecture in Amsterdam. Piet Kramer, he was born in 1881 and died in 1961, so he died at 80. And we are going to look through some buildings by him. Again, the School of Amsterdam. And I admire these buildings. They are not banal, they include art, they include bas reliefs, they include sculptures. Some I think that they are a little bit too busy. I don't know. I think it's a stimulating form of doing architecture. And it's both new and old. Piet Kramer. look at this majestic interior. You know, I don't know who could contest its complexity and its beauty. And it's not a cathedral or a church. This was the man. Look at the exquisite brickwork here, and not just the brick. You know, it's truly an architecture that required a lot of good craft. Look at the entrance into the building, which is special. It's an event. It's eventful. It's not just a banal, you know, rectangle, an opening into a blank wall. It has character. Here he collaborated with Michel de Klerk, and we already saw this building, but now we have maybe some other images with it, and I find it very special, this building, although it's a modest building in the sense it's not very big. And again, the beneficiaries were working class people. But how splendid that such an architecture, rich in also in cultural and even spiritual connotations, was dedicated, was animated by socialist ideas. So monumentality was not, to be offered only to the rich, but also through the talent and work of these architects to those, you know, so-called common people. Unfortunately, his later years were dedicated entirely to, well, it's nothing wrong to build bridges, but for some reason he didn't build any longer buildings like this, and he built many bridges in Amsterdam. So again, this is Piet Kramer, it's not Michel de Klerk, but they worked together on this building. It's medieval and modern at the same time. And now this villa, built in 1922, is a part of that park that I showed in a previous presentation, short presentation, the one on the School of Amsterdam. So the park that I showed then, and now I'll show some other pictures, was created on the initiative of the Amsterdam tile dealer Arnold Hasty in the difficult years of the First World War. He commissioned this person, Stahl, whom he knew from the Architecturae Amicizia Society, and approached four young architects to work with. And here are their names, and the last one in the grouping is Piet Kramer. Hasty gave them complete freedom in building 17 country houses on a specially purchased plot in Bergen. 7 detached, 2 double and 2 three-part villas. The only condition was that they would make ample use of his styles, Hasty's styles in the interiors. All the villas were built between 1917 and 1918. So, at the end of the First World War. Now we see what Piet Kramer did, but no, this was not preserved, but there is a building by him that was preserved. It's just a picture of it. It doesn't exist any longer. You can see his name in the lower right corner, P.L. Kramer, architect. I'm not sure if this was built by, but I think it was built by him. Anyway, these buildings are similar. And I would say that this kind of architecture employing organic matter or materials is, sustainable enough for our time as well. Back to blocks of flats in Amsterdam and some detail. There was a lot of imagination, to create these buildings. Look at the windows, they are studied, they are in themselves, architectural events. Now I'm beginning to show towards the end of this presentation on Pete Kramer, some of his bridges. Brugge is a bridge, number 400. He designed many, I don't know if 400, but many of the bridges in Amsterdam were designed by Pete Kramer, an important member of the Amsterdam School or the School of Amsterdam. And these are still expressionist structures relating very much to what we already saw by these two architects, important architects of this architectural movement. This one too, it's itself like a mask. These two windows are almost like the eyes of a face. Staring at us. Even the handrail and the parapet they of the bridge required a lot of artistry and craft, as we remember from the Walter Gropius manifesto for the Bauhaus. As in the vision of Walter Gropius, the artist was still a craftsman. Both the craftsman and the artist were rooted in craft, with one exception. The artist was an exalted craftsman. So this exaltation transformed craft into art in Walter Gropius thinking. Another housing project. This is a, I don't know if it still exists, an important, mall, 19 department store, 1924-1926. And I think this was the last building that he built, and afterwards he only built bridges. But I don't know if it still exists. Maybe it was demolished or ruined during the Second World War. Hello, Mr. Kramer. Today is the birthday of your former partner, Michel de Klerk. There are similarities between his work and that of Michel de Klerk, yes. I didn't plan to talk about Pete Kramer today, but since the presentation on Michel de Klerk was rather short, I thought perhaps I should show some things by Pete Kramer as well. Another bridge, another working complex. I mean, an apartment building for working class people. A cafe or a patisserie, I mean, you know, some kind of a store to sell cookies and so on. Anyway, this is another bridge, Brug 43. Another bridge. Well, he died in 1962, I think, so in the 60s. So architecture became more and more, you know, kind of free of, you know, sculptures and masks and so on. This is a housing complex that he did, still inspired by the aesthetics of the School of Amsterdam. Maybe also by his collaboration with Michel de Klerk. You see here the building they built together or designed together. Another bridge. A villa from 1929. This one rather traditionalist, unfortunately. Well, it seems after the death of Michel de Klerk, Pete Kramer also began to, I don't know, who knows exactly what their relationship was, but I think the architecture he built during the time when Michel de Klerk was alive seemed to be more interesting than what he built in his later years. A monument from 1934-1935. This was before the Second World War. Another bridge. More and more modern. This is from 1942, so the war was there. But more and more functionalist. Now, what is this from 1947? Another bridge. Gun is the sculpture. Gun is mythology. Gun is the mask. Now we have, you know, the highway. It became functionalist. Okay, that's it. So now we'll end our meeting today with talking about a North American architect who himself deserves more than I offer today, but still, it's our way of saying happy birthday to him. Walter Burley Griffin, born in 1876 and died in 1937. So he died at 61. And let's see. This was the man, an interesting architect, and his wife was also a very interesting architect. And if they live longer, well, she lived longer. She died in almost 90, but he died at 61. Here they are together. I don't know if this picture was taken in Australia or not. Grand Obsessions, the life and work of Walter Burley Griffin and Marion Mahoney Griffin. She was one of the first architects to receive a license in the United States to practice architecture. And they both met in the office of Frank Lloyd Wright. So Walter Burley Griffin, born November 24th, 1876, and died in February 11th, 1937, was an American architect and landscape architect. He is noted for designing Canberra, Australia's capital city, and Griffith in New South Wales. He has been credited with the development of the L-shaped floor plan, the carport, and an innovative use of reinforced concrete. Influenced by the Chicago-based Prairie School, Griffin developed a unique modern style. He worked in partnership with his wife, Marion Mahoney Griffin. In 28 years, they designed over 350 buildings, landscape and urban design projects, as well as designing construction materials, interiors, furniture, and other household items. Canberra. So they won the competition to design the capital city, the capital of the capital city, Canberra, and this is their project, and it does look interesting. Too bad was not built, or some parts of it were built, but what I look at here now, it does look impressive. And you can imagine they were very happy to go to Australia, to leave the office of Frank Lloyd Wright in order to start their own practice and their own career in very auspicious conditions. But unfortunately, I don't know the details why this was not implemented, but he did some very interesting works. And I regret now I didn't prepare a larger presentation on him. He does deserve it, and there are aspects of his work I truly admire. Let's look at some incinerators that he built in Australia, which I find very interesting, because this is a function that, you know, unless we consider a very interesting building by Hunterwasser in Vienna, in Austria, also for an incinerator, you wouldn't think that an incinerator is, you know, inciting an architect to build an exceptional building. But look at this, and he built several. And they are monumental, and they are in a way paying homage to fire. The incinerator works with fire. And, you know, it's an architecture that has this symbol. Which and metaphor, which shouldn't be neglected in architecture, if possible. In fact, I thought of, as I said, I thought of maybe making another presentation called Bricks and Incinerators to talk, by the way, of Michel de Klerk and Walter Burley Griffin. Newman College, I think I have a few more images with incinerators, or at least one more. But he built several in Australia. This college in Melbourne is also interesting. You know, it's, you would say it's not very, 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 you know, future oriented, but we cannot deny its qualities as architecture. Very different from Frank Lloyd Wright, indeed. Now, another incinerator in the suburb of Brompton, South Australia, known by the name of the adjacent suburb, Hillmarsh. This one also, I would say, an excellent building, an excellent brick building. And now we know a little bit about brick because we just saw Amsterdam buildings by Michel de Klerk and Pete Kramer. But this is different. It's a different architecture, still done with bricks, done in Australia by two North American architects. Another incinerator in the suburb of Tebarton in South Australia. This one also, you know, I mean, this could have been a church. Well, it's not a church, it's an incinerator. It's a, you know, a totally, you know, you would say prosaic building, but the building is not prosaic. I don't know if it was a book published on the incinerators of Walter Burley Griffin, but I think easily a book could be published, or at least a doctorate paper can be written on this special program that he served through his buildings. Back to the university, you know, that he built. And I mean, just this detail and shows the, you know, the tectonics of his building, which are very convincing. especially for someone like me in our time, where just today I read about metaverse being some kind of living in non-physicality, but metaverse for being from the word universe, replace uni with meta, so you get metaverse. It was published today on Arch Daily, an article about what is called metaverse architecture. Here is Griffin would have nothing of that. This is a tectonically rich and real and convincing architecture. Now, I don't know if Marion Griffin did this drawing or this rendering or not, but it doesn't matter. I was talking about his wife. They work together, they live together, they're in Australia. And I think they built some interesting buildings, and this is one of them. Cafe Australia. I mean, even this building, this interior is not to be neglected. Is not to be, passed by, with indifference. No. And although I'm sure that they received some influence from Frank Lloyd Wright since the time they worked with him, I would still say that this is the original architecture. Even the outside of the building now, it's you cannot ignore such a building. There was skill, no doubt. Both Walter Burley and Marion Griffin, they both had talent. Now, I don't know if all the architects born on the 24th of November, are so imaginative and so rich in the accomplishments in architecture, but somehow I see some relationship between Michel de Klerk and Walter Burley Griffin. A sculpturalness, a romantic spirit, appreciation for organic materials. Although their architecture is very different. Now, this is a building in Melbourne, a tall building, but even this building is, we have to say it, rather original and, almost striking. And not only because of its size, if we are to compare it with its neighbors, left and right. Sorry, the resolution of the picture is not great, but we can see here again, the visceralization of architecture through the sculptural motifs and elements. And also through ornaments. Now, the roundhouse, the Walter Burley Griffin house in Castle Crag, also, I would say, a rather interesting house built with stones. The Fishwick house. Castle Crag, 8 kilometers from Sydney. Walter Burley Griffin. just like in the case of Michel de Klerk, my presentation on Mr. Griffin would have benefited from a more ample effort, but maybe by next year I will be able to achieve it, because I'm actually very interested in the work of both. Another house, sorry for the resolution. Here are better pictures, but fragments of the house, a lot of vegetation, in the proximity of the house, probably attracted by the seductiveness of stone. It's a telluric architecture. It's an architecture that is indeed earthy. Sorry about this. And now another house. I don't know who did this rendering, if it was himself or his wife, but it's a good drawing and yet a little bit different from the works of Frank Lloyd Wright. Interesting also that on the site plan, they rotated the house. Now, house in Evanston. It happens that I lived for a few years in Evanston, which is a suburb of Chicago. And I passed by this house. At that time, I didn't know it was by Griffin. I thought it was Frank Lloyd Wright. It's actually an excellent example of the skills of Walter Burley Griffin. I am nostalgic now, I confess. I biked many times by this house. This is more similar to the works of Frank Lloyd Wright, but shows maturity in design and in the handling of the, the volumes, the articulation of the various parts of the building. It's a fine building. I'm sure Frank Lloyd Wright would have acknowledged that it is a very good building. Designed not by him, but by his former employee, Walter Burley Griffin. Okay, that's it. So let's wish him happy birthday, and I thank you for being here today.